Singing. Well, if you have your Bible open to John chapter number 1 once again, we continue in the study that we've begun now in John's Gospel with the Lord's help, studying verse by verse all the way through the Gospel of John. And so just getting started in it, I believe this is either the 7th or the 8th message that we're studying together this morning. And so we're in John chapter number 1. And we're picking up with verse number 19. John chapter 1, verse number 19. Want to look today, and actually we'll need to be more or less going into a second part of this over the next week or so. Looking at this thought of the record of John the Baptist. It's how verse number 19 begins. And so notice, beginning with verse 19, we'll read today down through verse number 23. And this is the record of John when the Jews sent priests and Levites from Jerusalem to ask him, "Who art thou?" And he confessed and denied not, but confessed, "I am not the Christ." And they asked him, "What then? Art thou Elias?" And he saith, "I am not. Art thou that prophet?" And he answered, "No." Then said they unto him, "Who art thou? That we may give an answer to them that sent us, what sayest thou of thyself?" And he said, "I am the voice of one crying in the wilderness, make straight the way of the Lord, as said the prophet Isaiah. Let's pray together. Lord, thank you for the reading of the Word of God this morning and the opportunity that you've given us now to study your Word together. And Lord, we pray that by the preaching of your word and the presence of the Holy Spirit, that we can receive your word today, that we can learn, that we can be equipped. Lord, that we might be able to serve you better. Lord, that we might be pleasing to you. And Lord, we pray also that souls would be saved. Lord, that the Spirit of God would change people's lives. and that you'd send us revival. And so we do pray for those that may see, hear the message online today or later or another day, that you'd speak to their hearts as well. And Lord, we just ask that you just hide us behind your cross. Lord, that we'd make much of Jesus today. We'd make much of you, Lord. For you alone are worthy of our worship and our adoration and our praise. We thank you for what you've done. We thank you for what you're going to do. And it's in Jesus' precious name we humbly pray. Amen. 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 Thank you. Be seated. Thank you for standing for the Word of God. Let me mention to you that from verse 19, actually all the way down through verse number 37, here in John chapter number 1, we have with the record of John the Baptist, we really have in this section the first of many witnesses that prove that Jesus Christ is the Messiah. And so in looking at John the Baptist and the record of him and what he did and who he was, it's really reinforcing the main theme of John the Apostle, the writer of the Gospel as we study it. It's reinforcing the main theme of the deity of Christ, of the fact that Jesus Christ is God. You say amen. That he was in the beginning with God, that he was God. He is God. He is the Word of God made flesh. And so the record of John the Baptist, we can see, has been given in three different days in the scriptures here, three different days to three different groups of people. And each time he would speak of Christ in a different way or a specific manner. And you see this by looking down to verse number 27, where John said of Jesus, "He it is who coming after me is preferred before me, whose shoe latchet I'm not worthy to unloose." He tells it in verse 29 down through verse number 34. The next day, John seeth Jesus coming unto him and saith, "Behold, the Lamb of God, which taketh away the sin of the world. This is he of whom I said, after me cometh the man which is preferred before me, for he was before me, and I knew him not, but that he should be made manifest to Israel. Therefore am I come baptizing with water. And John bare record, saying, I saw the Spirit descending from heaven like a dove, and it abode on him. And I knew him not, but he that sent me to baptize with water, the same said unto me, upon whom thou shalt see the Spirit descending and remaining on him, the same is he which baptizeth with the Holy Ghost." Verse 34, he said, "And I saw and bear record that this is the Son of God." And so you've got those two days, those two times there. Verse 35 and verse 36, we have a third time where it says, "Again the next day," so it's a third time, "again the next day after John stood and two of his disciples, and looking upon Jesus as he walked, he said, Behold, the Lamb of God." And so these three instances where John is giving a witness of the fact that Jesus Christ is God, a witness of his very deity. And so understand these events that we just read about, that these things with John, they took place just a few months after John's baptism of Jesus. And so really early on in the gospel account here. Now I want you to call your attention to verse number 19 again about John the Baptist, where it says, "And this is the record of John." And this record of John, understand that John, we know, is one that was born into a priestly family. His father, Zacharias, was a priest. He belonged to the tribe of Levi, and he preached. When you study John's preaching, you know that he preached the need for spiritual repentance. And so, notice how it says, and this is the record of John, when the Jews sent priests and Levites from Jerusalem to ask him, "Who art thou?" These priests and Levites, you see, they knew who the Messiah was. They would preach about the Messiah. They would believe that God was sending Israel the Messiah, that the Messiah was coming to deliver them and set up his kingdom on the earth. They believed that. And it really appears that they may very well have thought that perhaps John the Baptist could be the Messiah. That would have been their thoughts. In fact, the text indicates that. And so they may very well have thought that John the Baptist was the Messiah. And so these priests and Levites, you know, that would be something that they would be interested in, wouldn't it? They of all the people in Israel and in Jerusalem in that day, don't you know they'd be interested in trying to figure out whether this John that they're hearing about and all that's going on out there in the wilderness with his preaching, his baptizing, all the things that he's doing, you know that they're interested in wanting to check this thing out. He might just be the Messiah. And so they wanted to know. And so the thing about it here, we find out, the only way that they could find out was to do what? Ask him. Ask him. And so that's what they're doing. These priests and Levites, they've come out from Jerusalem to ask him. And there are two questions, actually, that we'll be looking at. We'll look at one today. We'll look at the next question next time. But we see the question in verse 19 through verse number 23, our text for this morning. Who art thou? Who art thou? And then there'll be another question that they're trying to find out about. And that's in verse 24 through verse number 28. And that is, why baptizest thou? These are some things they wanted to know from John the Baptist. They wanted to ask him. They wanted to know about these things. They wanted to know, who are you? And they wanted to know also, why are you out here baptizing people? And so it's interesting things to look at. We're going to look at the one question today. And that is that question of, who art thou? From verse 19 down through verse 23, as we have read for our text. And we'll just divide this up in two ways. It's really quite simple to outline this and a quite simple way to understand it. They ask the question, who art thou? And so in verse 20 and in verse number 21, John gives them an answer. And he begins, first of all, he tells them who he is not. He tells them who he's not. Verse number 20, and he confessed. And denied not, but confessed, I am not the Christ. And so there we see that indication that some, including no doubt these priests and Levites, they thought that maybe he was the Christ. Maybe he was the Messiah. And John, you'll notice they didn't even get a chance to ask him that in particular. He knew what they were looking for. He knew what they were wondering about. And so he confesses and says to him, I'll tell you this much, I'm not the Christ. I'm not the one you're thinking about. I'm not the one that you think you're looking for. I'm not that one. He says, I am not the Christ. John the Baptist knew that he was not the Messiah. And so he tells them that he was not the Christ. And then in verse number 21, and so they asked him, what then? It's almost like, you know, when he responds and says, I'm not the Christ, without them even having to ask, are you the Christ? Are you the Messiah? And he says, no, he tells them right up front, I'm not the Messiah. I'm not the Christ. And so they come back almost like really wondering about this thing. He says, well, who are you then? If you're not the Messiah, if you're not the Christ, well, then just who are you? And so they begin to suppose something. They say, are you Elias? That is, are you Elijah? Are you the prophet Elijah? Come back. And he said, I am not. And then they said, art thou that prophet? And he answered, no. Now the Bible tells us, and now this is what's really interesting. And you think these priests and Levites, they have evidently had an idea of this. And it's how the scripture tells us that the prophet Elijah will return before the Messiah establishes his kingdom on the earth. And so they no doubt were looking for that. Malachi chapter number 4 in the Old Testament, Malachi chapter number 4 and verse number 5, they knew the prophet Malachi. And Malachi wrote this. Chapter 4, verse 5, behold, I will send you Elijah the prophet before the coming of the great and dreadful day of the Lord. So these priests, Levites, you have to understand, they've studied these things from the Old Testament scriptures. They've studied this. They're understanding this. They're looking for this Messiah to come. If he's not the Messiah, well, maybe he is the coming of Elijah. That the scripture says that Elijah will come before the dreadful day of the Lord comes. That Elijah is going to come. And in Luke chapter 1, verse 17, if you remember, when the angel appeared to John the Baptist, his father, Zacharias, when he was performing his priestly duties there in Jerusalem that day, and the angel appeared to him. And it tells us in Luke chapter 1, verse 17, the angel that spoke to Zacharias, and he said this concerning the son that he would have, John. He says, and he shall go before him, and that is before the Lord. And in verse 16, he says, many of the children of Israel shall he, that's talking about John the Baptist, turn to the Lord their God. And he shall go before him, that is, go before the Lord their God. He shall go before him in the spirit and power of Elias, to turn the hearts of the fathers to the children, and the disobedient to the wisdom of the just, to make ready a people prepared for the Lord. And so the angel told Zacharias that. That's what your son that you're going to have. That's what John, you're going to have a son. You're going to name him John. And this is what he is going to do. But he says that John would go before Jesus, and notice, in the spirit and power of Elijah. Doesn't say that he is Elijah. But says that he will, that this John the Baptist comes and will go before Jesus, before the Messiah, before the Lord. He will come before the Lord in the spirit and power of Elijah. And so that would be indicating to us that that there can be another one, not a literal Elijah, that could fulfill that prophecy that we just seen in Malachi chapter 4 and verse number 5. See, it would come in the spirit and the power of Elijah. And so we see in Matthew chapter number 17. Matthew chapter 17, for instance, and looking at just a couple of verses there, verse 10 down through verse number 12. Matthew 17 and verse number 10. Here's when the disciples are speaking to Jesus, and this is after he'd come down from that mount we refer to as the Mount Transfiguration, where he took Peter and James and John, and there both Moses and Elijah appeared before them, and they saw Jesus in his glory, and we've already looked at that, and John was an eyewitness of this. And so in verse number 10, and his disciples asked him, saying, why then say the scribes that Elias must first come? And Jesus answered and said unto them, Elias truly shall first come and restore all things. Now watch this carefully. He says, but I say unto you that Elias is come already, and they knew him not, but have done unto him whatsoever they listed. Likewise shall also the Son of Man suffer of them. And he says, then the disciples understood that he spake unto them of John the Baptist. Jesus told them Elijah will come. And he told them Elijah has come. And he's referring to John the Baptist here. And so God sent John. Here's what we need to understand. God sent John, who was like Elijah. Same type of mannerisms, similar in his preaching and the way he would preach, and same type of a prophet. And so Jesus said, he's come, but they didn't believe it. He's come, but they wouldn't receive it. He's come, but they won't believe what he's saying about the Messiah appearing, about Jesus himself, because they were rejecting him. They were rejecting Jesus. And so they rejected Jesus means they rejected the message of John the Baptist. Amen? I mean, it just makes common sense. And so it really kind of gives the idea, perhaps, that if the Jews, if the priests and Levites and the Pharisees and Sadducees, if they had really believed John the Baptist, and then if they had then received Jesus and believed him to be their Messiah, then you could say that John the Baptist in this day very well would be the one that fulfilled that prophecy that Malachi gave, that Elijah would come first. But they didn't believe him. It's still going to be that Elijah is going to come. I believe we see Elijah as one of those two witnesses in the book of Revelation in the time of the tribulation period. But Jesus is saying, he's making us to realize when we see that in Matthew, he's saying that and teaching them that John the Baptist is Elijah already come. He's come in the spirit and the power of Elijah. That the prophecy is for the forerunner to come, and he'll come like Elijah. He'll come in the same spirit and the same power. He'll be a prophet like Elijah. He'll be a preacher like Elijah. That's what we need to understand about it. But then Elijah will appear in the tribulation period, the real the man Elijah, the prophet Elijah. And so they're confused. They're asking these things. Well, just who are you? Are you the Messiah? He said, no, I'm not the Messiah. Are you Elijah? And he says, I am not. And then they ask this question, art thou that prophet? You see that? Art thou that prophet? There in verse 21 again, and he answered, no. Now, Moses is the one that prophesied of this. You find it back in Deuteronomy chapter number 18. Deuteronomy chapter 18, two verses there, verse number 15. Moses told the people, the Lord thy God will raise up unto thee a prophet from the midst of thee, of thy brethren, like unto me, and unto him ye shall hearken. Verse number 18 of that same chapter, Moses told the people this, that God says, I will raise them up a prophet from among their brethren, like unto thee. God told this to Moses. He said, I'm going to raise a prophet up like you, Moses. I'm going to raise up a prophet among their brethren like unto thee, and will put my words in his mouth. He shall speak unto them all that I shall command. That's what Moses did, isn't it? And so God told him, says, I'm going to bring that prophet. That's what the priests and Levites are concerned with right now. They're saying, well, if you're not the Messiah, if you're not the return of Elijah, well, are you that prophet then that Moses was had prophesied of? That God would raise up a great prophet like Moses who would function as God's voice, which is what Moses did, isn't it? Moses would function as God's voice. Moses would be the one that God would speak to Moses. And the amazing thing about it, the Bible tells us that God would actually speak to Moses really as a man to a man. He didn't speak to the rest of them. He didn't speak to Israel. He didn't speak to Aaron like that, the high priest, Moses' brother. But boy, he had something going with Moses, didn't he? And he's got something going with Jesus. Jesus, in fact, is one with the Father. And Jesus would even tell us that the words that I speak to you, they're the words of the Father. He would tell us that the works that I do, they're the works of the Father. He would tell his disciples, the Father is in me, and I am in the Father. And as you said, I and my Father are one. He told them, if you've seen me, you've seen the Father. You see, it's like hand in glove together. As Moses was the spokesman of God Almighty, of the Father in heaven, Jesus speaks for God. Now, because Jesus is God, he is one with God. He was in the beginning, he was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. And that Word, John says, was made flesh. We beheld his glory. The glory is of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and of truth. God would raise up a prophet like Moses that would function basically as God's voice, that would speak for God. And Hebrews tells us that in these last days, God has spoken to us by his Son. He said he spoke to our fathers in the old days, if you will. He spoke through the prophets. But now, he's in these last days, He speaks to us through his son. That's Jesus Christ. And but when they ask him, art thou that prophet? There were those, I understand that, and there are some that have interpreted, there are some that interpret this prophecy or had interpreted the prophecy as saying that, well, that prophet that Moses said that God's going to raise up, well, it's going to be another forerunner of Messiah, you know, as John the Baptist. And so that would have been what these priests and Levites would have been wondering about. If that prophet that Moses prophesied of would be the forerunner of the Messiah, they're saying to him, well, is that you or that prophet? But understand this, the New Testament applies the passage of Moses to Jesus. And so when they said that prophet, that's not talking about John the Baptist, that's talking about Jesus. They said it's Jesus that would carry the voice of God, amen? It's Jesus that would speak as God spoke to Moses. Jesus is the one to come and to speak because Jesus is God. And so it applies to him. We see it in Acts chapter number 3. Acts chapter 3 and verse 22 and verse number 23. As Peter is preaching here, and he says, "For Moses truly said unto the fathers, a prophet shall the Lord your God raise up unto you of your brethren like unto me. Him shall ye hear in all things, and whatsoever he shall say unto you. And it shall come to pass that every soul which will not hear that prophet shall be destroyed from among the people." And you study the context of that, it's talking about Jesus Christ. It's just like at the beginning of Acts chapter number 3 when Peter and John came across that crippled man at the beautiful gate of the temple, and he asked for some help, and he said, "Silver and gold." Peter told him, "Silver and gold have I none, but such as I have, give I thee. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, rise up and walk." The whole context of the chapter is about Jesus. And so Peter understands it. He applies it here in his preaching and in his message that this prophet that Moses prophesied of is the Lord Jesus Christ, and that you'd better hear him. Also in Acts chapter number 7. And here when you have the story of Stephen and his message, they ended up stoning him to death. But in Acts chapter 7 and verse number 37, Stephen told them this is that Moses which said unto the children of Israel, "A prophet shall the Lord your God raise up unto you of your brethren like unto me. Him shall ye hear." And you read Stephen's message, and it's all about the Lord Jesus Christ. Because he told them that he called him the Just One in Acts 7, verse 52. He said that they had slain him. He said that they were that they murdered him. And so it all goes to him. And so no, John is not that prophet. That prophet is Jesus. So these priests and Levites, that's what they're trying to know. That's what they're wanting to understand of John the Baptist. Who art thou? Talking about the record of John. And they said they want to know, who art thou? And so he tells them who he is not. And then, secondly, in verse 22 and verse number 23, notice this. He tells them who he is. He tells them right at the beginning, "Now I'm not who you're thinking about. I'm not the Messiah. I'm not Elijah. And I am not that prophet that Moses told you would come." But here he says, "This is who I am." Verse 22, "Then said they unto him," they asked him again, "Who art thou? That we may give an answer to them that sent us. What sayest thou of thyself?" Now, the thing about it is, you know that John the Baptist had really been stirring up the whole countryside. Amen. If you studied the story, you know how that in Matthew chapter number 3, in Matthew chapter number 3, how that the Bible tells us concerning his preaching there in the wilderness outside of Jerusalem. Matthew chapter 3, let me read a little bit. I'll begin in verse 1. Matthew chapter 3, verse 1. "In those days came John the Baptist preaching in the wilderness of Judea, and saying, Repent ye, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. For this is he that was spoken of by the prophet Isaiah, that's Isaiah, saying, the voice of one crying in the wilderness, prepare ye the way of the Lord, make his path straight. And the same John had his raiment of camel's hair and a leathern girdle about his loins, and his meat was locusts and wild honey. And then watch this now. Then went out to him Jerusalem and all Judea and all the region round about Jordan. And we're talking about thousands, about tens of thousands, maybe hundreds of thousands of people. You know, and it's a multitude of people. And they're going out there. They're making their way on out into the wilderness. They're making their way out to find this one that they're hearing about, this man that is called John. And so when we see this in verse 22 in our text, and in our text, then said they unto him, who art thou, that we may give an answer to them that sent us? You see, these priests and these Levites evidently were sent by the rulers of the temple. They were sent to find out what's going on. And when you read the account of John's preaching and so forth in all of the Gospels, there are many times that there were Pharisees that were there. There are priests that were there. John called them a brood of vipers. And of course, Jesus called them hypocrites. But they wanted to find out what all the excitement was about. They wanted to find out, well, what's going on? And so they sent these priests and these Levites out to ask that question. Well, who art thou? What sayest thou of thyself? Give us some kind of answer that we can take back to those that send us. And John gives them an answer in verse number 23. He said, I am the voice of one crying in the wilderness, make straight the way of the Lord, as said the prophet Isaiah. And he's quoting from Isaiah chapter 40 and verse number 3. Isaiah chapter 40 and verse number 3. The voice of him that crieth in the wilderness. Notice, prepare ye the way of the Lord. Make straight in the desert a highway for our God. John is quoting Isaiah, and he's applying this to the soon appearance of Jesus Christ. And he says, I'm the one that comes before him. I'm the one that is to point the way to him. He says, I'm not him. I'm not Elijah. I'm not that prophet. I'm not him. I'm not the Messiah. But John was a messenger. Can you say amen? That's who he was. The words that he spoke were the words that God had gave to him. John was the messenger of God. And so in his message was to prepare the hearts of the people to receive the Lord once he's introduced to them. And so verse 14 and verse number 15 in the text, and the Word was made flesh and dwelt among us. We beheld his glory. The glory is of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. And verse 15, John bare witness of him and cried, saying, this is he of whom I spake. He that cometh after me is preferred before me, for he was before me. Now it's significant that in Isaiah's prophecy, as it speaks of watch this, I'm going back to Isaiah 40 and verse number 3. The voice of him that crieth in the wilderness, prepare ye the way, and watch the emphasis here, prepare ye the way of the Lord. Make straight in the desert a highway for our God. You see that? It's significant that in Isaiah's prophecy that you see those words. That this is what John the Baptist was to do, prepare the way for the Lord. Make a straight path for our God. Make a highway in the desert for our God. It's very significant that the coming one that Isaiah is telling about, and the one that John the Baptist is saying, this one that will come after me is preferred before me, for he was before me. John is, and quoting from Isaiah, is letting them know that this one that he's telling them about, this one he's preaching about, this one that he is telling to them, he's on his way, buddy. He's right around the corner. He says, this is the one who is both Lord. In Isaiah chapter 40, it's the word Jehovah and God. And there's the word Elohim. He is Jehovah. He is Elohim. John is recognizing that the one who he says was before me. He's recognizing his pre-existence in eternity. And he's also recognizing and understanding that he is in fact the Lord of life and he's the God of creation. That's who he is. He says, that's who I am. I'm just a voice in the wilderness. I want you to think about this about John. We'll maybe get to it later, but in another place, Jesus told his disciples about John, and he says, there's no greater than John. He basically tells them there's not a man in this earth born of woman. There's not a single one that is as great as John. But he says, even the least in the kingdom of heaven is greater than him. I think it's a wonderful and interesting thing that in all of this, they're questioning him, who are you? Are you the Messiah? I mean, what if somebody asks you, what if you got something from somebody that asks you a question and you understand they're thinking you're the Messiah? Or they're thinking that they think you're Elijah that's come back. They think that, boy, you got to be Elijah. They think if you're not the Messiah, you're not Elijah. Well, you're that prophet that Moses said would come, that would speak the voice of God like Moses would do. The words of God like Moses did. He says, you're one of these. But John just goes, he just says, no, I'm not. I'm not any one of them. He says, I'm just a voice. I'm a voice. You get a real glimpse of what Jesus was talking about when he said that the least in the kingdom of heaven is even greater than John. John thought of his own self. I'm just a voice. I'm not the Messiah. Nobody should worship me. I'm not Elijah. I'm not him. Maybe he could say, maybe you think I remind you of him, but I'm not him. He says, no, I'm certainly not that prophet that Moses was talking about. That prophet that Moses is talking about is the one that's coming after me. The one that is preferred before me. The one that I'm not even worthy enough as a slave to bend down and loosen his shoelaces. You see, that'd be the work of a slave. When the master would come into the house in that day, it'd be the slave's job to loosen the shoelaces, to help him get his shoes off where he could wash his feet. It'd be the slave's job to do that. And so John basically is saying, I'm not even worthy to be his slave, much less for you to think of me as Messiah, Elijah, or that prophet. I'm not even worthy to kneel down before him and be a slave to him. But he says, I am this. I am a voice. A voice. John the Baptist agreed with John the Apostle. When John the Apostle said, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God, the same was in the beginning with God. All things were made by him. Without him was not anything made that was made. And in verse 14, the Word was made flesh, dwelt among us. We beheld his glory. The glory is of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and of truth. John the Baptist agreed with John the Apostle that it's all about him. It's not about me. It's all about him. He says, all I am is a voice. And we need to probably in this generation as much as at any other time, realize and understand that that's all we are. We're just a voice. We're a voice in the wilderness. There's nothing grand. There's nothing in this day of the mega churches and the rock star pastors on the television and all these sort of things. I'm just a voice. That's all I am. That's all John the Baptist was. But I don't know about you, but dear friend, I'm glad just to be a voice for him. And all of us are to be voices for him. Amen? Amen. Let's go ahead and stand together, our heads bowed, our eyes closed for prayer. Let me say to you this morning, dear friend, if you've never trusted Jesus Christ as your Savior, you need to realize this. It's not about you, and it's not about any number of things that you put a lot of stock to. No, my friend, it's about him. And we need to take the example of John the Baptist and say, I'm not even worthy to be his servant, but I tell you what I am. I'm his voice. And even in the wilderness, I'm going to be his voice. You see, it's all about Jesus Christ. Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life, and no man cometh unto the Father but by me, according to John chapter 14, verse 6. He's the only way of salvation. He's the only hope of eternal life. Friend, you're not going to, if you're trusting in having been baptized, you're trusting in having joined the church, or you're trusting in the fact that you've always been in a religious family, my friend, you didn't realize, understand, none of those things is what saves you. None of those things is what gets you to heaven. You've got to have a personal relationship with him that only comes by way of what the Bible tells us in John chapter 3 is being born again. And Jesus said, even to Nicodemus, a very good man, very respected man in the Jews' religion in that day, Pharisee, Jesus told him, you've got to be born again. You're never going to see heaven. You're never going to know God unless you, even as great a man as you may be, you've got to be born again. I believe the Baptist is a good example of that. He said, I'm not anything but a voice. What are you, dear friend? Are you his voice? Do you know him as your Savior? If not, why don't you trust him today? Call upon his name. The Bible says, whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. Wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. For by grace are you saved through faith, that not of yourselves. It's the gift of God. It's all about him. It's not about you. It's not about us. It's about him. And what we have to do is recognize just who we are and what we are, like John the Baptist recognized by his own self. He says, I'm none of these great things, but I'm just a voice. We recognize that apart from Christ, we're sinners and on our way to hell. But he took our place on the cross, and when we believe and trust in him, he'll give us of his life. He'll give us eternal life. And forgive us of all of our sins. If you've never experienced that new birth yet, dear friend, our prayer at Grace Baptist Church is that you would consider that you will, that you would call upon the name of the Lord just as soon as you will. He'll not turn you down and not turn you back. He'll save you as he promises he will for whoever will believe and repent of sin and call upon his name. And that's what we would pray for you today. Let's pray together, church. Lord, thank you for the word of God. Thank you for the awesome record of John the Baptist, of just who he really was, what he was. He was a voice. And Lord, we too should be your voice. And we too need to be your voice. And Lord, we pray that you'd help us to do so. Lord, we pray for those that have not been born again, that you'd speak to their hearts, draw them to yourself, that they might be saved before it's too late. We'll thank you for what you do. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. and amen. Let's sing together, church, as Brother Tim leads us.
Page 284.